Hello and welcome to Global System Science, Global Climate Change Unit. In Chapter 7, we discuss how computer models are used to help make predictions about what will happen to the climate in the future. The IPCC, or the International Panel on Climate Change, is charged with taking the best knowledge that scientists has to offer about how our climate works and debating that vigorously amongst the scientists that work in that field to decide what the effects will be on the global climate in the future. These findings are submitted to the public and policymakers as a general report that comes out every 5 to 7 years. Now, to do this, the largest tool that they have at their disposal happens to be computer modeling. And computer modeling is nothing new. We use it in financial markets, weather forecasts, and understanding the very large and the very small, like in astronomy or chemistry. In the case of global climate change, it's like putting in a number of ingredients that make up our climate and deciding what we're going to get out, somewhat like making a stew. In the case of global climate change, we have to understand a lot of different dynamics. And when you put them into the computer, they're called inputs. We need to input things like the interaction between the oceans and the air. How will large systems react? Winds, how much solar energy, which is variable, is coming to our planet? What about different things that human activity adds to the climate? Greenhouse gases, aerosols, etc. Those go into the computer model. So it's the programmer's job to take each one of these inputs and put into computer language how each of these behaves. Each one of these inputs collectively gets sent through a program and they're processed. And what we get out in the end are predictions, outputs. We can ask for outputs about that predict the temperature, the rainfall, where there's going to be droughts, where there'll be heavy snowfalls, all sorts of physical conditions that result from different climate situations. Each one of these inputs has physical parameters, things that we can measure. However, it's not that simple. What about all those uncontrollable human factors, those things that we can't predict? Let's take a look at a few of those. Nationalism. Will countries have a strong sense of their own identity and borders, or will there be a lot of cooperation? Cooperation among countries tends to even out economic development, which makes for less consumption of energy. What about deforestation, or how much tree planting will there be? This has an effect on how much greenhouse gases will be entering and retained in the atmosphere. What about power usage? Will we continue our consumption of fossil fuels? How much alternative energy will come into play? What about new technologies? And then the biggest factor of all, what about the planetary population? And how is that going to change in the future? Even planetary population is controlled by all these other factors: nationalism, cooperation, economic development. They're all part of the picture. And the IPCC has developed, in order to make decisions and make good computer models, they've inputted different kinds of scenarios, different combination of all these human factors that they place on top of the inputs, and they send it through the computer model. Each time we change something in this big question mark area, we end up with different outputs. And that's what this graph is all about. Let's take a look. In this graph, we're taking a look at just one output. You can see it over here on the y-axis, global surface warming. And on the graph, you will see different lines. The black line covers what we already know in the 20th century. What has the global surface temperature been over that time? And I want to draw your attention to the gray area that adjoins the black line. This is our line of uncertainty. How confident are they in that measurement? The wider the gray line, the more uncertain the measurement is, the more variation. And you can notice here that as we get closer to the present day, scientists are more and more confident that they're doing a really good job at accurately measuring surface temperature. And that's going to be an important thing to take a look at as we move through analyzing the rest of this graph. And then the other lines of this graph are different scenario families, groups that contain mostly the same characteristics, but we're going to vary one or two things. And that's where we get the line. The average of all the scenario runs for that family is on the colored line that goes with that family. The broad, lighter colored line of that color, in this case, it just shows the variation of the different scenarios. And down here, last, it says the year 2000 constant concentrations. We're going to say we've somehow managed, we don't know how, to keep all the concentration of greenhouse gases stable at 2000 levels. What will happen to our global temperature as a result? So in your next activity, you're going to be asked to take a look at what are some of the human factors that you think went into leading to each one of the following families. What do you think made the greatest rise? What combination of human decision-making leads to the greatest rise? What about the least rise? What do you think humans had to do in order to hold the constraints of 2000? So good luck with this investigation.